More music variety.
Liberty Radio.
Be inspired on Liberty Radio. For we know that the whole creation groans and labors with birth pangs together until now. We live in a time of birth pains. All creation, nature and the human soul, suffer a terrible pain of those who realize the time is about to come. And you need to know what is coming. Wednesday, 21st August. We will have the night of the groaning of the soul at 7:30 p.m. at the Cathedral of Miracles, 232 Seven Sisters Road, Finsbury Park, London, N43NX, or at any Universal Church near you.
Good morning, everyone. May God bless you in the name of the Lord Jesus. Today, Wednesday, and every Wednesday in the church, is the day of understanding God's Word for our lives. You know, a lot of people have access to the Bible, but they don't understand what God is trying to tell them. And the Bible for us is like a compass, a map, a GPS that helps us to navigate our life here in this world. And for those who have given their life to the Lord Jesus and those who want to learn to follow the Lord Jesus, Wednesday, the Bible study is essential. So if you are not usually a person who attends the church on Wednesday, make sure that today you will be here. You still have time for the 10 a.m. service, 3 p.m. and especially 7:30 p.m. Tonight, I'll be here 7:30 with all of you, and you can attend in every UCKG. We'll be having the same faith in every UCKG. And speaking of every UCKG, Monday now will be a bank holiday, and it will be a very special day because we are going to have the inauguration of our brand new church in Bristol. And look how special next week will be, because we are going to inaugurate Bristol on Monday, and on Sunday, the Sunday afterwards, we will inaugurate Seven Kings, two churches in 1 week. Isn't that wonderful? We believe that many souls will be saved. All right, listen, today I have something very, very special to tell you. We are going to watch a testimony right now, and then immediately afterwards, you will see how people perceive literature. We went to the streets of London to ask people, what is the most impactful book that they've ever read in their whole lives? We're going to see what people have to say about this. Stay tuned. Don't go anywhere. Be blessed by this testimony. We'll come back to put the Word of God before our eyes.
Faith played a part in making me believe in myself to start off with and actually fighting towards having a real transformation in my life. I had gone through about 3 attempts of sexual abuse as a child. One that really marked me was when I was called to come to this place. As soon as I entered, the door shut behind me, and I found myself in a room full of young boys around my age at the time, and an older guy that was touching me inappropriately whilst all the young boys were there watching what he was doing. I screamed. I guess he got scared that the neighbors would hear us. something. He backed off a little bit, so I managed to open the door and run away. I had so much domestic violence going on in my house. My mom was in a very abusive relationship. She was a very young mom at the time. Home was just not a secure place to be at. I remember there was even one event where I was about 10 years old. My mom was in a very violent argument with her partner at the time, and he took out a massive knife to stab her with. And myself being 10 at the time, my sister was about 5. I remember putting her on my back, running out of the house to go and get help. The only person that I could think of that could help was an older sister that my mother has that lived about 2 hours away from us. So when we got there and told my auntie what was happening, her and her husband rushed us back to see my mom. Thankfully, when we got there, my mom was just seriously injured, but you know, she was alive. I thought, okay, well, perhaps now my mom is gonna start showing some more affection towards me. But that was not the case at all, because by the next day, they were all, you know, loving on each other. My mom would often beat me, and so would her partner. He was heavily addicted to alcohol as well. So he would be very violent, you know, aggressive when he would hit. I was often very suicidal. There was constantly thoughts in my mind saying, you know, well, kill yourself. Your mom doesn't love you. So one day I decided to actually put that into action. So I decided to run across in front of a moving vehicle, was hit by a car, was left on the floor unconscious. There were people all around me. They called my mom, the ambulance took me to hospital, and then my mom came running to the hospital, you know, worried of my child, what happened. And in that moment, for the first time, I saw that, wow, my mom actually cares about me. I felt that I had some sort of attention from my mother. It made me develop an addiction towards self-harming and, you know, putting my life in danger purposely just so that I could get the attention from my mother. At the time, my father was not living in the country, he was abroad. I actually came from a polygamous family. That was one of the reasons why my mom decided to separate from my father. She didn't want me to get in contact with him, but I went through her things, found his number, and I contacted him, told him what was happening, and he came to get me. So coming to the UK, I found myself jumping from home to home. Being the only child that my mother has with him, but then having several other siblings, I felt like the black sheep in the family. Also, I had gone through a lot of paranormal activities where I would hear voices, I would see things, to the point that I would wake up in the morning, I would see scars, bruises in my body because I couldn't speak the language. I was bullied at school when I came here to the UK. And the only way that I knew to defend myself was through violence. In a way, that made me gain some sort of popularity. And to the point that, you know, when I eventually managed to learn English, I started finding myself associated with people that were gang affiliated. Used to get bullied about how my physical appearance as well. So I never felt comfortable being around women. I never felt comfortable identifying myself as a female. I would be around guys, I would want to dress like them, walk like them, talk like them, and became a tomboy. When my mom came to hit me at one point, I retaliated to the point that she ended up in hospital. The entire family hate me even more and, you know, say horrible things that I wouldn't amount to anything in life. And those words resonated with me for many, many years. So my stepmother at the time came to realize that my behavior wasn't normal, and then she invited me to come to the church. So when I came to the church, people seemed genuinely happy, and I wanted that. I would hear the pastor speak about how my life can be transformed. So he started speaking about the Holy Spirit, how he can give you a new heart, how he can give you a new nature. So I wanted that. And then that's when I decided to make the changes in my life. That's when I decided to get baptized in water. I started putting into practice everything that I was learning and seeking help from those that were in a position to help me. I just threw myself completely. I said, you know what, God, I'm going to tell you my whole life. Even though I knew that God already knew who I was, where I was coming from, but I felt the need to go back to the moments where I felt the lowest and tell him everything. And it was as if God became my therapist. What I never felt comfortable showing to people, I was able to put that out to God. And that's when he started to show me what was inside of me that was impeding me from having an encounter with him. I went back to my mother. I asked her to forgive me until one day when I was seeking God and I said, you know what, God, I don't know what else to say. Like, I've said everything that was inside of me. And that was the day that God filled me with his spirit. And for the first time in my life, I came to know what love truly was. I am completely different. I no longer go through those paranormal activities that I used to go through. I'm no longer that angry, aggressive person. I no longer have the insecurities that I had. I don't need to dress like a guy anymore. I'm confident being a woman, being who I am. From someone who was constantly told that I would amount to nothing in life, I've actually gone ahead and done something with my life. I recently actually graduated from university with a first class honors. I am progressing in my career, which is within the field that I studied. My life is just totally different. I found peace. I have great relationship with my family, all of them now see me as an example of transformation and of faith. God, you know, is able to use me to help many people who are currently going through all the situations that I went through. So definitely I wouldn't be who I am today if it wasn't for the Holy Spirit.
All-time favorite book and why?
The Bible, and 1 Corinthians 13 is my favorite chapter and verse because it speaks about love and it defines what love is, and it's the love of the Father towards us, and it's the love that we're supposed to give to other people.
The Eye of the World series by Robert Jordan, because it's such an epic fantasy series, and there's the way everything joins together and moves and the depth of the characters and the storylines that come through. It's just amazing. You can see other fantasy links coming into the books, but he's written it so well. Oh, it's a brilliant series to read.
Gone Girl, I'm gonna go for. I read it before I watched the movie, and so the plot twists, they just kept coming. Reading it, you never know what's gonna come, and then it just changes in ways that you didn't think it was going to.
It's a book called The Guest List by Lucy Foley, and it's my favorite book. I really, really love crime books, but especially like proper murder mysteries, which hers are. And in this one as well, not only do we not know who the murderer is from the beginning, we also don't know who's been murdered. And it flips a lot between like past and present. And so you're trying to figure out who you think also has been murdered, which I just think is a really interesting way of doing it.
The Wind Rush, the book on The Wind Rush, which was written by Trevor Phillips.
Have you ever read the Bible? If so, what do you gain from it? And if not, what has kept you from considering reading it?
I have not read the Bible. When I was younger, I used to have a children's Bible, but that's as far as I've gone for the Bible. I'm not religious, so I think that's the point that I didn't read the Bible for. Yeah, other than that, there's no reason for me not to read it. But I think I would, as in just more like to gain more knowledge.
Bits of it, as I went to quite a religious school. So we had religious studies, lessons twice a week, and we were very well versed in the Old Testament and quite well versed in the New Testament. Morals mainly, a lot of morals from nowadays now that I have my own children. Not necessarily, I mean, the stories of the Old Testament are fantastic because you can use them to show a bit like Aesop's fables and things, but you can show that right and wrong so easily with them. So that's what I took away from it.
I've only read small bits in school. I don't know what's kept me from reading it. I guess just that it's quite long, and I guess that's intimidating. I am a Christian, but only, I guess, loosely. I wasn't raised in the church or anything, so I guess reading the sections we did, it was just insightful as to what Christianity actually was about.
Read it at school, obviously, when we were taught in RE. These days I'm a devout atheist, so yeah, I don't really follow or subscribe to any religion.
I haven't read all the Bible. As a younger person, I always went to church and Sunday school. So there's favorite parts that in the Bible and quotes that, especially like the Lord's my shepherd prayers and that. And there are times when I read passages out of it, but I've never sat down and just took it up like a book and read the whole of it because I wouldn't understand all of it.
I do read the Bible. I read it every day. And what I gain from it is an understanding of who God is, where I fit into this world, and also how I can behave in a better light towards other people.
You know, what I really liked about this particular questions on the street is that there was someone there who said, look, I don't particularly read the Bible. I have read the Bible when I was younger. But I believe that the morals of the Bible, now that I have children, are very important, and I try to bring them into my family. You know, the Word of God is something that is so special, so spiritual, so amazing, so life-giving, that you would have to convince an atheist, or an atheist rather, would have to make a very good argument for not wanting to read the Bible, even if you don't believe in God. Because even if you don't, the principles of God's Word, they are like the foundations of a house. If you look at society right now, and actually most countries in the world, let's not say most, but many countries in the world, perhaps most, they have the foundation of the laws of their country on the Bible. The Ten Commandments were the first set of laws given to a people. And today, when you think about, for example, not stealing, why is stealing wrong? Well, because the Bible tells us that that's a mistake, that's a sin, and there's a punishment that comes with that. And today in law, that is very much the case. But I don't want to talk to you about the Bible as a book of laws that tells you what you can and what you cannot do. And by the way, let me just tell you that I was very surprised that the first person we asked said the most special book he's ever read was the Bible, right? The young man there. But look what the Bible, the Word of God says. Pay attention to this verse in the Gospel of John. It is the Spirit who gives life. The flesh profits nothing. The words that I speak to you are spirit, and they are life. The Lord Jesus said that His words, the words of God, are spirit and life. You know, when you hear someone say something to you, whether positive or negative, that has an impact in your mental state. How many people, they entered into depression or they grew up feeling inadequate, feeling like a failure because of things that they heard when they were small. Someone talking down at them. At the same time, there are people who grow up believing that they can do anything, that nothing is too hard, that there's a way out for every problem you face because they grew up hearing words from parents and family members that they could do this. And so it built in them this strength. When you look at things more short term, in the same way, if you start your day, imagine you wake up and someone calls you, you pick up the phone and it's your boss. And your boss says, look, you've just been promoted. When you come in to work today, you're going to come in with a new job title. You've been promoted, new salary. You know, nothing has changed. Your bank balance hasn't changed. Nothing's changed. But those words, they make you leave your house already different. That sets up your day to be a great day. The opposite is also true, that you can leave your house and, you know, in the morning you get a call and it's some bad news, and that sets the mood for the rest of the day. And these are words of men. Now imagine the words of God. The Lord Jesus said, "My words, they are spirit and they are life." The Word of God is not a book. A book that someone wrote, a bunch of stories, a collection of stories. The Word of God is life. His words are life. When we talk about people that, you know, they are with their backs against the wall in terms of dealing with problems, overcoming problems, what is going to take that person out of that situation is not someone trying to help them. That may help in a way, but there are situations that only the Word of God can help. And we have many testimonies of people who said, "Look, I was in the church and I heard a word, I received the word, and the word that I heard really made me see that things could change. It made my faith awaken. And because of that, the life of the person changed." Because when you receive a word from the altar, you are not receiving the word of a pastor or whoever it is. Because the pastor may be speaking, but it's the Word of God in the mouth of the pastor. The Lord Jesus said, remember, we just read here, He said, "The words that I speak to you are spirit and they are life." No matter what problem you are facing right now, if you decide to believe, if you decide to put your faith in these words, to deposit your faith in this word, to put these words into practice, your life is going to change. And Sunday now, 10 o'clock in the morning, in all our churches, not just here at the Cathedral of Miracles, but in all our branches, will be the Sunday of hope, the day of hope. I'm talking to you now that you feel hopeless. I'm not inviting you to come to a church service. Listen, we're not calling people who say, "You know what, this Sunday I'll go to your church, next Sunday you come to my church." No, no, no. If you're looking for a nice day out, listen, you'll be welcome, but that's not going to change your life. I'm calling you that you have nowhere to turn. You are in this city, perhaps of London, of almost 10 million people, and yet you feel alone because no one knows what you're going through. Or you are in a village somewhere, or you are in a smaller city, perhaps you are, you know, in a place where you are a stranger, like Nuria's testimony, that when she came to this country, she didn't even speak the language. And so she felt alone in this world. And to make matters worse, she had a lot of problems at home. Maybe this is you. But just like Nuria's life changed, yours can change as well. This is your opportunity. Nothing happens overnight, but Sunday now, the day of hope, can be the beginning of a transformation in your life. I've got here the glass of water ready. We are going to bless the water in just a moment. Prepare yours, and then afterwards, we are going to leave or end this program with the thought of the day. Prepare the glass of water. Let's talk to God.
Let's talk to God. It's time to pray.
My Lord, you said that your words are spirit and life. And when we spoke here this morning, we are talking about you. We are talking about your words, my Lord. If we were talking about the words of a person, we wouldn't expect any change. But we are talking about the words of the living God. And so, my Lord, I ask you that you let your words right now to have an impact on the life of this person, to transform the life of this person who, my Father, has been under pressure right now because of so many problems that are happening in her life. Who knows, my God, this person was diagnosed with an illness and they have the pressure of looking after their family, and they don't know how they're going to do that. Maybe this person hasn't been able to work, to do anything. But I ask you, my Lord, that the power of your word, your power through this person's faith right now, may bring strength to this person's body, healing to the organs that are failing. Manifest your power, my Lord, in the life of this person to transform, to change their situation. My Father, for those who didn't have a physical illness, but for those who were perhaps discouraged, tired of life, burdened by life, let your power bring strength, encouragement inside of this person's heart. In the name of the Father, the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, we consecrate this water. You may now drink of it and receive strength. Next time that you question, you ask yourself, should I read the Bible today or not? Remember these verses, or this verse. Jesus said, my words are spirit and life. Why wouldn't you put his word before your eyes every single day? Let's go now to the thought of the day.
And now, the thought of the day.
The thought of the day today is, every time you read a book, you are drinking of what the writer has within. Choose carefully the fountain that you drink from. Every time that you read a book, you are reading of the ideas of the writer. A writer can write, you know, about anything. A writer can write a story that has, for example, that promotes promiscuity, that promotes the opposite of family values, that promotes violence. And when you read that book, you are drinking of that fountain. So it's very important that us as Christians, and it doesn't mean we only read the Bible, you are free to read other books. I sometimes read different books, but we have to be very careful how many people today, they subscribe to a way of life that is contradictory to the principles of the Bible because of something they read that goes completely against their faith. A book has the power to change the way you think. So don't read a book because it's popular. Don't go to a bookstore and look at the top 10 selling books of the month and say, well, these must be good. Perhaps they are good because they are good at changing people's minds into thinking in a way that is contrary to the faith. So be very careful. Remember, when you read a book, you are drinking of what the writer has within him. If the writer has a lot of violence within him, if the writer has a lot of ideas about the world that are harmful, and you read that, that's going to be inside of you. Maybe you say, Bishop, but I can pick and choose what I take for myself. Our brain is a sponge. When you read, you are absorbing what you read. You may say, I don't want to subscribe to this, but the seed has been planted, and that can be sometimes very harmful. God bless you. We'll see you here tomorrow, 7:30 in the morning, same time, for one more Be Inspired. God bless you. Thank you.